What's good, y'all? Welcome back. In this video, we're going to continue our conversation about how to create vectors in MATLAB. Recall in a previous video, we explored colon notation to create regularly spaced row vectors. The syntax we used in that previous video was on the left-hand side of our assignment operator, we wrote the row vector name for our desired variable. Then we used the equal sign to define a new row vector. That row vector used two colon operators. The first entry of this syntax is what we call the value of the first entry of our desired vector. So J would be the first entry that we want to put in our vector. Then we define an increment size or a desired spacing between elements that goes in between our two colon operators. And then the right-hand side was a bound for the last entry of our vector. In the case that the increment size is an integer and the starting value is an integer, this bound is very easily calculated. A great example of how to use this going up by fives, let's go ahead and start at, negative 10. We'll go up by positive fives and we'll go all the way up to 20. Oops, of course I have to use the assignment operator. MATLAB was getting mad at me there. Notice that I'm going negative 10, first entry of my vector. We go up by five, so I already know that I wanted to increment my vector by sizes of five, and I go all the way up to 20. We saw in that previous video that if we did 21, that was an upper bound because of course I can't get to the actual value of 21 using this start value of negative 10 and the increment size of five. The colon notation was super helpful to create vectors if we already know the size of our desired increments before we actually define the vectors. In other words, if I know where I want to start and I know the sizes that I want to create, colon notation is a really powerful way to do that. However, there are many situations in mathematics where we might not know a priori beforehand what size increments we want to create, but we do know that we would want regularly sized intervals in between a known start and a known endpoint. Riemann integration is one such application. When we do a uniform discretization of an interval, we take the end of that interval, the start of the interval, and then we cut the interval into linearly spaced sections. If I only know the start and the end of that interval, I don't necessarily know the size of each interval length. And in fact, the number of discrete points very much determines that size. In that situation, the colon notation would not be most appropriate. Instead, MATLAB provides us with a function called linspace to create linearly spaced row vectors. Of course, one of the things that I'm going to recommend as we start to get to know this function, let's take a look at the documentation of linspace. So in this case, let's go ahead and type help linspace. That opens some small help documentation at the start. Let's open the documentation for that function. Notice that there are two different ways to call linspace. That's exactly what's being stated here. So the description for linspace is it generates a linearly spaced vector. The syntax is either I write y equal to linspace of x1 comma x2, or another way to write it is y equal to linspace of x1, x2, x3. In the first syntax option, we only have two input arguments. In the second syntax option, we have three input arguments. Let's go ahead and read a little bit about the description here. This returns a row vector with 100 evenly spaced points between x1 and x2. If I do not define the third input, let's go ahead and check that. First thing we'll do is we'll clear this screen, and then we'll set x equal to linspace of, let's start with 0 to 100. Huh, that wasn't exactly what I expected. I wonder what happened there. Let's try that again. We'll say linspace goes from 1 to 100. Oh, of course, MATLAB said in its documentation that if I don't define the third argument, linspace will give me a row vector with 100 equally spaced values. In this situation, if I start at 1 and I go to 100, that's 100 different entries. For now, let's go back to the documentation and look at the second option for syntax where we have three input arguments. So y becomes linspace, linearly spaced vector, starting at x1, going up to x2, and then there's this third argument called n. In this case, we're claiming that that function generates n different points. So I can tell MATLAB how many points I want to generate using that call. Moreover, it tells me that the spacing between points is given by this definition. Let's go ahead and try that. So let's suppose that I wanted to create a vector y using a linear spacing between points. We'll start at the number 2, we'll go up to the number 4, and we'll create 5 points. Notice in this situation, I know the start, I know the end, and I know the number of values. Linspace produces a 1 by 5 row vector. Let's go ahead and say that x1 in this case was 2, x2 in this case was 4, and we saw that n was equal to 5 in this situation. The reason that I think this is helpful is MATLAB is claiming that the size of the spacing between individual elements in my vector should be given by this formula. Let's go ahead and check that. So x2 minus x1 divided by n minus 1. In this situation, we're claiming that x2 was 4, x1 was 2, and then we're going to divide by n minus 1. Well, n is 5. So notice I have 2 on the top and 4 on the bottom, which says that my spacing should be equal to 0.5. Let's go back to the previous example where we did lin space of 0 to 100. And the claim is that we didn't actually define n, so the default value was 100. That produced a vector that was 1 by 100. And then we wanted to know what was the size between the individual entries of this. Well, MATLAB claimed that that size was x2 minus x1 divided by n minus 1. In this case, this was 100 was x2. So we'll go ahead and write 100. 0 was x1, so we'll go ahead and write 0. And then remember, the default value of n, if I don't define it, is 100. So 100 divided by 99 is 0.010101, and that is the size of the spacing. On the other hand, when we did our first example of lin space starting at 1 going to 100, we knew that x2 minus x1, well, this is going to be 100. X1 was going to be 1. And then on the bottom, we said that this value was 100. Well, 99 divided by 99 is 1. And that's exactly why we see that the increment size between each of those elements is 1. Let's go back to the documentation. Notice MATLAB is telling us that lin space is similar to the colon operator, but it gives us direct control over the number of points we're going to have and always will include the endpoint. Remember that weird feature of the colon notation where sometimes it would not include the endpoint. Lin space will always include x2 as the last value in that endpoint. Last thing MATLAB says is that this has a sibling function called log space, and that generates logarithmically spaced values. We're not going to explore that at this moment, but the point of the matter is we can do more examples. For the next example, let's suppose that we're going to create the vector x equals 0, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, but we wanted to do it using lin space. We immediately see that the start and end of that vector is known. So we've got 0 to 10. The question is, how many points do we want here? Well, in this case, we want 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 points. And that's exactly what we've done there. Let's try another one. Let's try to get this vector y equals to 4, 4.25, 4.5, 4.75, and 5. Notice that for lin space, we know the exact start of that vector, which would be at 4. We also know we want to end at 5. How many entries do we want in that vector? We want 5 entries. Let's clear that screen. And then I want to talk about a common mistake I see in lin space. Sometimes I see young students that see this vector and say, oh, the increment size between those elements is 0.25. So if I'm going to create that vector using lin space, what I'll say is the value is 1/4. So what I should do is start at 4, go up to 5, and then the increment size is 1/4. But notice this element in lin space tells me the number of entries in my vector, not the size of those entries. On the other hand, that would be a really, really good way to do using colon notation. I know that each increment is of size 0.25, and I want to start at 4 and go to 5. Notice the difference between those. Lin space is really, really good when I know the exact number of entries that I want, and I know that I want the first and last entries to be predefined. Colon notation is really good if I know the start of this, but I also know the increment size, and I don't have a good of idea of the last entry of my vector. So they're kind of complementary functions in that way. Let's clear this space. The last thing I wanted to call out is that we can actually do lin space function definitions for decreasing values. So specifically, if I said that the first entry of my vector was going to be 60, I want to go down by 1, and I want 11 different values. Notice that will start at 60, will go down to zero. And the increment size will be defined by our calculation. X2, which is zero, minus X1, which is 60, divided by 11 minus 1. Well, 0 minus 60 is negative 60. 11 minus 1 is 10. Negative 60 divided by 10 is negative 6. And that's exactly what we see in this definition. I start at 60. I go down by negative 6. I go down by negative 6. And there are a total of 11 entries in the value of z, which is exactly what we expect from Lin space. The last note we're going to make in this is to talk about what we call function overloading. We've seen this in a previous video. Notice Lin space has a very, very different behavior depending on how I type in the entries. In the first situation, I have three arguments, and the third argument tells me the number of entries I want in my vector. In the second situation, I have only two arguments, and MATLAB imposes a default value that says that the vector produced by Lin space when I do not put the third entry in will be of size 1 by 100. So the default number of columns will be 100. This is an example of function overloading. We're using the same function with two different contexts or two different syntaxes. In other words, this function only has two inputs. This function has three inputs. But the fact of the matter is the same function name is being used here. We'll talk more about that in future videos. But the reason I thought this was important is when we see different syntax options, each option has its own meaning associated with the same name. So as we're learning to read documentation, it's kind of useful to know these different syntax options in this case are what known as function overloading, because we're calling the same function using different syntax and they actually produce different results. One way to learn more about what's happening inside the box is actually to, in the command window, type open lin space. This will actually open the lin space file that MATLAB uses. Notice that MATLAB is declaring this as a function, and it's saying that y is equal to the lin space of d1, d2, and end. Here's the little help documentation. So notice this commenting actually will show up. You can kind of see that by just comparing. Look, lin space is a linear space vector. That's exactly what we said. Remember, in our documentation, first we had the title. That's exactly what we've done. And then a short description of what the actual code does. Then we answer the question, what problem does this function solve? Which is exactly what MATLAB is telling us. Then we give some examples of how to use it. And then the C also. There's no author information because this was written by a team of MATLAB coders probably over many years. As we scroll down here, notice that the first thing that MATLAB is going to do is check the number of arguments. So if the number of arguments is equal to 2, please define the third argument n as 100. So remember we said that if you only write two arguments into lin space, that the third argument will be 100. That happens right here in the code. It says, otherwise, if the number of arguments is not equal to 2, it says, please set the number of arguments to be the floor of a double of n. Don't worry about that. That's a little bit beyond the context of an introductory course. It's basically just trying to interpret whatever the person put in as a properly rounded double precision integer. The next thing MATLAB is doing is some error checking. So in this case, it's checking if not is scalar. So is scalar is a function that checks whether or not the input is a scalar. So the claim is, check the input is a scalar. If it's not a scalar, or the second input is not a scalar, or the third input is not a scalar, please give an error message. MATLAB's lin space requires scalar inputs. Let's go ahead and check that for ourselves. So let's define a vector to be 1, 2, 4. And then let's do lin space of that vector. Maybe we'll go up to 5 and we'll say that we have 10. Check that out. I just triggered this error message by putting in this vector, and that's exactly what we see. The next thing we see is some various conditions on how to define this having to do with data classes. It would take me at this point in my life probably 2 to 4 hours to fully understand this code. For a novice student, it might take multiple months to understand what's happening with the difference between single and double classes and the different conditions that they have. There are some useful pieces of information for you advanced viewers. Please have fun with this. I did want to show a little bit about the error checking and what happens with that third variable using the first few conditions. We'll end with a tutorial part of this video with a recap of what we learned about Linspace. So to create linearly spaced row vectors using the Linspace function, we use the following syntax. On the left-hand side of our assignment operator, we're going to define a variable name, which is going to be a row vector. Then we're going to use the equal sign as an assignment operator. On the right-hand side, we're going to call the linspace function, which creates linearly spaced vectors. We use the left open parentheses to start to find the input of that, the right close parentheses to show where the input ends. And then we can have either two or three arguments. The first argument will always be our desired initial term. The second argument will be the desired end term. And then n will be the number of points that we want in our vector. If we do not define the third input, MATLAB will automatically set that input equal to 100 so that the standard length of a linspace vector is 100 unless we specifically define what that value will be by writing that as the third argument to our function call. Remember, we said that linspace was kind of a cousin to or complementary to what we called the colon operator. In the colon operator, we have the same idea of creating a row vector, but instead of using linspace, we used J colon I colon K. In this case, J was kind of playing the role as the first input or X1 in linspace. But then instead of knowing the number of actual entries in my vector, we knew the increment size and we did not know the endpoint. In particular, we saw that when using colon notation, we didn't have control of what the end would be. We had control of the size. So linspace really good for having control of defining the first point of the vector, the endpoint of the vector, and then the number of entries. Colon notation is really good for defining the first entry of the vector, the increment size, and then if we don't care so much about the number of entries we have or the particular last entry, this would be a good option. That leads us into the community challenge for today. Can you come up with mathematical applications in which linspace would be a really good use versus colon notation would be a really good use? An example response to this that I might write in the comments includes, I might use linspace if I was doing some calculations having to do with Riemann integration and I want a uniform discretization of an input interval. So I knew the first point, I knew the last point, and then I wanted to chop it up into n pieces. For colon notation, I would use that for indexing arrays in MATLAB. Specifically, if I wanted to find a sub matrix of a larger matrix, I would really, really hone in on colon notation. Challenge for you all is to come up with your own examples and in the comment section below, let our community know. I also always welcome questions, comments, and feedbacks. When you give me feedback, my brain grows and my videos get better. Thanks so much for your attention, y'all. I'll see you in the next one.